Steve, here we are at the end of the season. When we sat here this time last year, it was at the end of a devastating loss in the semi-final to Munster. Things didn't go quite like that this season, and finishing eighth, you've had a chance now to look back on what went on in the season, and what are your initial thoughts?
Well, it was obviously a bitter disappointment, and it's something we've been chasing our tails from the start of the season in around the competition, and I think we probably clawed it back a little bit over Christmas and things, but ultimately we didn't finish it off. It's definitely a disappointed coaching team and players alike, and it's something that we don't want to be in these positions too often or ever again.
I think it's probably important to remind yourself that it is the nature of sport. There are ups and downs, and for all the highs you have to have lows. Every team in the world is all chasing the same thing, but probably doesn't make it an easier pill to swallow.
No, it doesn't. And like we said all along, there's a lot of excuses we could hide behind. There are definitely a lot of reasons that have contributed to where we are. But ultimately, as Ospreys, we always want to probably overachieve in a lot of aspects when you put into funding and squad size and things. And we did that last year, getting to a semi-final. And probably there are some outstanding moments throughout the season, in particular getting to potentially nearly making the quarterfinals of Europe. That was a pretty devastating loss for us, in particular having gone so far into the tournament and the stress and strains it put on the squad.
When you look back at the start of the season, obviously the losses that we had in the first month during the World Cup period, lots has been written and spoken about it already, but with the benefit of hindsight, a full season on, what do you look at, what do you think, and would you do things differently if you had the chance again?
Yeah, I think we're our harshest critic, and it's something we're always reviewing and constantly trying to get better. Probably in hindsight, that start period was extremely tough on us. Put a lot of pressure on a young group, and a couple of the signings we made probably didn't quite work out through injury and a couple of other sort of issues. So it's definitely something we've looked back at, and in particular sort of some of the young kids coming through, there's a real pressure on those to perform early doors and win games. Ultimately we didn't get that point, and I thought there's some inconsistency in around our form at that period. But I think then on the flip side, as devastating it is to finish eighth, it's something towards the back end of the season, and when you go to the Dragons, Blues and Millennium Stadium, a lot of those young kids that went through some tough moments at the start of the season, I think started to really grow and shown the help that development at the start of the season has held them in good stead. They've become more consistent, not just on the field, being more consistent off it, and around how you train, nutrition, your recovery. There's massive parts, and within a young group, they tend to get one or two things right, but sport, and when you look at the likes of Arlen Wynn and Biggs and Webby, they get the majority of it right week in, week out, in how they sleep, how they recover, how they do looking at the footage, how they prep the team. It isn't just about that 80 minutes on the Saturday that gets you to perform. And I think that's something, even through a lot of reviews individually as coaches and with the players, a lot of it comes back to our inconsistency of work. But I think a lot of youth have to go through those moments to realise what it does take to become a real professional rugby player, but also becoming an Osprey professional rugby player.
I think some of the key words that we quite often hear over the course of the season about attention to detail, knowing your role, being accurate, they're things that Monday to Friday, everything you do all help you build up to be the player you want to be on the Saturday or the Sunday afternoon.
Definitely, and I think it's when you see a lot of our senior guys, how they do it, and a lot of our younger kids now are starting, you look at the likes of Ollie Cracknell, Adam Beard, they do their work off the field. They are diligent in what it is, they continue to do it in training, and I don't think they're going to guess they're going to perform on the weekend. They know it because they're doing their work. And then, like, you look at Arlen Wynn. You don't see Arlen Wynn put in poor performance in the Ospreys, because even at the end of his career, he is, as in being a British Lion and what he's done in his career, he still recovers. He still needs to do, he knows he needs to do his homework. He does everything in his power to make the team better than himself on the weekend. And I think a lot of these young kids, it's getting new to it. But I'm definitely excited at what the group have gone through this year and the fact of what they've learned, but it's ultimately, you've got to learn from those experiences, making sure we become more consistent, because like I said at the start, we do not want to be finishing eighth in the table again.
Some of the challenges of the season have been well documented, obviously with the World Cup and the Six Nations. and probably one of the biggest challenges that you face on a week in, week out basis is team selection. You know, how do you cope with, how do you deal with that? You know, what's the thought process that goes behind some of the selections?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of thinking goes into it. I don't know, it's plenty of people got opinions on it, but it's something, it's not just about the Saturday, it's about the training week and who's consistent, who's performing, and some things it's about what's the right fit for the team, where people are mentally, what sort of state they are off the field. It could be the fact of someone's not quite where they need to be physically. They could have carrying niggles, they may not be doing their homework, and then you have to play some people out of position then, the likes of James King playing in the second row for periods with us. There's some injuries that go along with it, but then it also goes down to form, what people are, mental state they are on and off the field, and making sure that they're going to give everything ready for that team. But ultimately, sometimes we've got to pick people out of position. It's not exactly where we see them or want them to be, but we feel that is the best fit for the team when you look at every individual player, whether it be, are they going to be able to perform to the standard we need them to be on the weekend.
And sometimes selection is not always with one game in mind or next. Sometimes it's looking further ahead as well. It's not always just a case of getting the perceived best 15 out on the team at any one time.
No, it's nice. And I think the big thing, and it's probably something we've all, as coaches, we learn from, is the demands of the World Cup, demands of the training, the mental preparation that's gone into it, boys coming back. We knew probably a lot of the Welsh boys would fall away, not purposely, but they've had a lot of strains and demands mentally, preparing, all the physical sort of preparation that went in before the World Cup, the highs and lows of the World Cup coming back. I thought they started really well, but we knew at some point there's going to be that down period. They can't keep that up all year round, so it's something we have to plan for and cater for. And it's tough to manage a small group as it is with a lot of young kids. We want to succeed in both tournaments, but I mean, we have to pull people out and we have to manage. And I think the one thing going forward, which is exciting, I think we've got strength in certain areas that we will be able to manage and hopefully pull people out when they need a break. And sometimes I think in around the squad, the size we've got, we give people a break by having a couple of days off, but then we've got them on the bench, whereas they need a clean break to fully prepare for the weeks that are coming up, because we're constantly asking a lot of people to go to the well for us week in, week out, which is something I don't think we can sustain yearly.
Can you give any specific examples of that?
Yeah, I think it's trying to like manage the senior guys, and probably when you go in around, good examples of it are probably when we know if we beat Claremont and Exeter, we're going to get a quarter final. It was Leinster the week before. We give Alan tips a break, and probably we're giving them a few days off to come back in, whereas probably they need clean breaks so they can really re-energise and have a real focus. And that's something only comes with trust within the group. And I feel towards the back end of the year now, we are getting the likes of Beardy. Rory has learned from the inconsistencies at the start as well. We're seeing him adapt and understand what it takes to be a professional rugby player, and the demands of it and the recovery process in this, but he's going to gain from it. And these young guys are going to make mistakes and at the end of the day make poor judgments on and off the field, but it's something that they're growing and learning, and that's part of growing up to be really a true Osprey and a true pro. Whereas it's probably, if you've got that trust in the group, then you can probably, against Leinster, potentially leave Alan Wynn and Tips out of the squad completely, so they get really recharged, ready to go for other weekends. But it's something, that's just one example of it, because we know, we speak to these boys daily, they monitor daily around how they're feeling, are they, and the demands internationally, are the demands we put to them, and in particular, when we really go for it in Europe, we don't see it as an opportunity to rest people, we see it as an opportunity to go and win games and beat so-called super teams, and in the, like you look at now, Claremont and Exeter, the top of their leagues respectively, we've beaten those. There's really positive performances out in Claremont, and unfortunately I think probably the Exeter game was one too far for us, which is really disappointing. And then when you put the people we had missing at the time and the physical demands of big seasons for these guys, it's going to take its toll at some point in the year.
Just pausing on that Exeter game a moment, was that probably one of the most frustrating points of the season for you, particularly the way that things went on in France that afternoon and the way the pool finished? Probably the most frustrating afternoon of the season, perhaps?
Yeah, I think frustrating would probably be not harsh enough. It was definitely one of the lowest points my coaching career, being so close to something yet so far away and knowing a point would have taken us through. But I think it was understanding where we needed to be, and we weren't there. I don't think we performed like the way we wanted to, which is ultimately a bit of disappointment, and being so close to doing something that would have been I think a superhuman effort for such a young group, and a group that has had a lot going on, and the experiences they've got from that, like Sam Underhill, Sam Davis, our boys going to Bordeaux, and like we have had Sam in the centre, those kind of things where we've had a lot of injuries and things, but they've still found a way to do it. And it's something we would like to have been had a little bit more consistency through those windows and having a little bit more choice in around it. But it's something that was one of the lowest points of my sort of coaching or playing career, and being so close to doing something so special. But ultimately, we wouldn't change the fact of getting so close and failing. It's something that we'd prefer to be going into the last game in a shootout, as opposed to in previous years, we probably out of the competition after the first two games, which we don't want to be. If you look at Fonatia now, he was under the radar probably last season, but now I think he's having a fantastic season in around the competition, him playing in the Crusaders. I think he's one of the form players, and it shows if you do our homework and we're smart with it, then we're always going to get one or two wrong. But then when you look back at the ones we have got right in the Fonatia, both Canadians, Sam Underhill, the likes of Cracknell, even Dan Evans coming from the Dragons, those type of things, these boys have come through. You look at the season, which has worked its way out, defensively we've not been where we need to be, and I think the appointment will stimulate some of the senior group, but also shape a lot of the young kids in around how we defend as Ospreys, how we want to be. And I think Brad is definitely going to give us that energy, the detail in around what this work is.